It could be said that Game of Thrones Season 8, Episode 5, The Bells, is by far the most controversial episode in Game of Thrones history. Which is impressive because we've had this exact same thought after watching various other episodes, especially this season. But yeah, the writers just continue to one-up themselves in this controversy department. And I say the writers because from what I see, pretty much no one seems to have any problems with the rest of the production work, or with the performances from the actors. The only exception, of course, being the darkness in episode 3. But we've discussed that enough at this point. The controversy definitely surrounds, first and foremost, the writing. My question is, though, have we gotten to the point where we're starting to mix up objectivity with subjectivity? Let's discuss that. You're now watching Because Geek. Alright, let's get real here. There isn't a shadow of a doubt that the writing has taken an objective hit in quality. The evidence for this is very easy to find in many articles, Twitter threads, hundreds of YouTube videos, and all of the memes. Hell, even the actors are starting to admit it. Accepting this fact does not make you a hater, though. It makes you a passionate fan who is just rational. Now, being abrasive about your opinion, on the other hand, is, of course, not going to help you win over anyone from the other side, provided that's what you're trying to do. I understand the anger, though, from both sides, but there's no need to shame each other for the way that we each feel. Our feelings are not right or wrong, they just simply stem from different sources, like perspective, investment into the story, knowledge in certain areas, our own past experiences, and much more. And each of these is just as justified as the next. But where we can always do better is in trying to get our emotions out of the equation, and not let them cloud our reasoning. As long as we've taken a moment to consider that the other side might also have a good point because they're just as passionate as we are, then we've done well. And that's something I personally want to be able to do. I could sit here and list out all of the character inconsistencies, plot holes, continuity errors, excessive use of plot armor, and all of those things. But there's already so many other videos of people doing that, and they're doing it much better than I could. I may still make mention of some of them in this video, but they won't be the focus. Although, I think they can all be summarized into one argument, and that is the undeniable truth of the rush. I know for a fact that the majority of the audience agrees that these past couple of seasons have been very rushed, but it had never been as rushed as the past few episodes. While many of these character arcs could have been satisfying, we were robbed of that satisfaction by the way that they were executed. The reason this saddens me, and many, is because if only they would have taken their time to let things develop more organically, we could be having some of the best debates with our subjective opinions on these character arcs instead of clouding that with all of this hate towards the quality of the writing. Daenerys becoming a tyrant in a realistic way is, in my opinion, a brilliant character arc, one that I would 100% be okay with if we were to get it in the books. I would love to see that idea that George likes being played out, that a villain is simply a hero of the other side. I find a certain beauty in the ambiguity of that concept, if written properly. So, we know for a fact that George likes it, but I don't think we've seen it properly portrayed in the books just yet. And Dany is one of the best candidates for it. It's something that lines up perfectly with the judgment that we'd expect to see from the population of Westeros towards a Targaryen conqueror, and a turn in the story that would only be more powerful thanks to the fact that, as readers, we've grown to love Daenerys. We have followed her throughout most of her life, and we've experienced her struggles through her eyes. We've experienced her victories, her mercy, and her ruthlessness through her eyes. We understand where it all comes from, but the people in Westeros don't. Would it really be that unrealistic for her to have a really hard time earning Westerosi's love? No, of course not. We've been taught that in this story, no one really has an easy time with anything. There are also no slaves to save in Westeros, only free people to conquer. So we can't really expect her to get the same type of love that she got in Essos, unless she has the right advisors and followers by her side. But what if those advisors and followers began to die, slowly leaving her more and more alone, the same way that we have seen in the show? That, plus the unwelcoming treatment from Westeros houses, would take its toll on anyone's mind and patience. Daenerys slowly becoming more and more jaded by the Westerosi who, in her mind, are ungrateful, but in their mind are simply distrustful, is a really good story, a very real human conflict. If Daenerys ultimately does something that turns that distrust into an accusation of madness, it wouldn't mean that she's gone mad, it would only mean that she's being perceived as mad, and that would be extremely tragic. but it would feel realistic, which is consistent with what Game of Thrones has always been about. When we look at the story through that prism, having Daenerys win the throne in a peaceful way sounds next to impossible. Of course, this doesn't mean that Daenerys must go down this path of tragedy, it only means that it's entirely possible. I don't think George wants his entire story to be a tragedy, by the way. We all know that he said it would be bittersweet, so there's gotta be some sweet in it. But I also think that Daenerys ending up on the throne and everyone loving her and living happily ever after is a bit too sweet. That's just my opinion, but yeah. So if this tragic outcome for her character arc is not out of the realm of possibility in the books, then the main reason for its failure to feel possible in the show must lie in the execution of it. I don't think we lack the hints for Dany's downfall, it wasn't unreasonable to see it coming, but that doesn't mean that it wasn't contrived. A lot of those hints, especially this season, were not developed organically and felt awkward, forced, and rushed. And none of those hints were any clear motivation for her to kill innocent people after they had surrendered, and people who had done nothing to her. I mean, I can believe that she's capable of burning innocent people, she's done it before. But where was the motivation this time? She has always had a clear and realistic motivation, no matter the morality perspective behind it. I will say though, I was able to understand her agony, despair, and loneliness from everything that's been happening to her. Even by episode 2, I was already feeling really bad for her. Apart from the unwelcoming treatment that she received in the North, she's now lost 2 of her 3 children, her most trusted advisor and loyal friend, her only other loyal friend, a huge part of her army, Varys' loyalty, Jon's love, and the title of heir to the throne. Maybe when the bells rang, she realized that this emptiness feeling that she's been carrying from being hurt so much and having lost so much made this surrendered King's Landing feel like an empty victory too. She got what she wanted all her life, but she had no one close to share her success with, and no real love from the people. With the potential of those people turning against her in order to crown Jon looming over her, the one solution she had left was to instill fear and kill them all. The combination of these thoughts and emotions can play some really harsh tricks on one's mind. Maybe they overwhelmed her in that moment, maybe they all bubbled up to the surface and manifested themselves in a release of fury that she directed not towards the people themselves, but towards the city as a whole, and all that it meant to her. This city represented the beginning, but also the demise of her family. It represented the reason she lived a painful life, not only when she was growing up, but also in the process of getting it back. And now that she has it back, there are no good feelings that she can relate to it. It kinda makes sense when you look at it that way to want to make it all disappear. These are all very complex thoughts though, and most of their buildup would have happened inside of Dany's head. Something that you can easily convey in a book with POV chapters, but something that was basically only conveyed to the audience with a facial expression in the TV show, which is unfortunately not enough information for the viewer. Nothing against Emilia Clarke's acting, by the way, she did an amazing job with her face, but I think most of us will agree that the writing simply did not make things clear. Even the actress herself has implied in interviews that she wasn't happy with her ending, and how the audience would perceive her. And David and Dan are known to write things this way very often. Every time that the scripts for a season are released and we get to read them, we realize how much subtext there was in every scene that we couldn't get because they were trying to convey it through facial expressions. So this is not something new, they've been doing this for a long time. I personally managed to make my brain separate the character arc from its execution. Putting more focus on the arc itself and less on the execution allowed me to enjoy the show a bit more. Now, I'm not saying that this is something that the writer should be expecting the audience to be able to do. It's not an excuse for them, it's only a solution that I've been able to find for myself. But this is where I was trying to get to with my original question at the beginning of the video. Are we mixing up objectivity with subjectivity? To say that a character arc did not satisfy you simply because of the essence of the arc itself is most definitely a subjective opinion. A character turning from a hero into a villain as an arc is not objectively bad writing. It's something that you either like or not like, depending on your personality. But the execution of it, the character's actions, the consistency, the dialogue, the pacing of the story, all of that in-between stuff can definitely be objectively weak if it doesn't follow standard narrative rules. The reason it gets tricky to judge this episode is because character arcs and execution are almost one and the same, so they can be hard to separate. I like to think of the arc as just a starting point and a destination. Anything can happen in between, but that to me doesn't change the arc, if the starting point and the destination are still the same. George could have definitely told the showrunners that Daenerys would eventually destroy King's Landing and be seen as a villain. The difference is that he would have written it like this, and the showrunners wrote it like this. This is objectively good narrative, and this is objectively bad narrative. But since the arc has the same beginning and end, it's not objectively better or worse in either of these examples. That part is only subjective. This is what I see in my head when I judge the show now, and I feel that it allows me to judge it both objectively and subjectively. I'm not telling you that this is how you should judge the show. This is just what worked for me, and what allowed me to enjoy the show a bit more. And if it worked for me, then it might work for others, so I figured it's worth a share. We have a similar situation with Jaime. I was not expecting his arc to end up like it did because of the way that he was being executed, but it might surprise you that I was nonetheless very much pleased with it. Again, thanks to being able to separate the character arc from its execution. I do understand why a lot of people had a problem with him going back to Cersei. I just don't think that's where the mistake was made. I think the mistake was made when the writers made Jaime sleep with Brienne. Without this particular event, I think his arc would have been more believable and more satisfying. Taking Brienne's virginity did not only hurt Jaime's arc, but it also unnecessarily took away from Brienne's, a character who had already gotten what she wanted most in life, to be respected and recognized as someone worthy of becoming a true knight. She didn't need to be brought back down by Jaime rejecting her later. Jaime respecting Brienne and making her a knight was the highest point in both of their journeys, and it was incredible to witness, but their relationship should have stopped there. Even though Jaime, in a way, loves Brienne, he's always been loyal to Cersei, which was actually one of his strangely redeeming qualities. As Jaime said to Catelyn way back, he's only ever slept with one woman, and that makes him more honorable than Ned. Of course, Ned never slept with anyone else, but you get the point. Jaime going back to Cersei is a realistic love story. Jaime sleeping with Brienne was a fanfiction love story. It was something I definitely wanted to see as a Braemy shipper, but it was also something that unnecessarily took away from both characters. In hindsight, I would have enjoyed each of their stories a lot more if that didn't happen. Jaime is quite a complicated character, and based on what we've seen from him in the books, I can completely understand why so many people are horrified at what they did with him in the show. But let me say that if written properly and realistically, having Jaime go back to Cersei in the books could be a very good story as well. They were brought into this world together, and they were always meant to leave it together. They've loved each other their entire lives. Jaime didn't need to realize that Cersei was toxic, he always knew she was, and he still loved her anyway, like Tyrion said. And yes, it would have been a lot better if Jaime died at Winterfell like the hero that he's supposed to be. That would have been a perfect end to his arc as well. But I'm trying to work with what we've got here. Since he didn't die fighting the dead, then going back to Cersei, to me, is the only other realistic outcome. I would not be able to believe that if he's loved Cersei his entire life and remained loyal to her up until just 4 episodes ago, that he could just completely disregard that love and let her die alone or even kill her himself. I mean, what kind of person would Jaime be if he did that? In my mind, in the show, he's actually just staying true to his loyalty qualities. I was happy to see him fulfill his duty of fighting against the dead and showing respect to someone like Brienne. That was his redemption. But if his redemption also meant forgetting his love for Cersei completely, it wouldn't feel right. It would feel too Disney. And we know Game of Thrones is everything but Disney. Jaime going back to Cersei is realistic and consistent with the rest of the realism that we've learned to expect from Game of Thrones. It's a beautiful love story in its tragedy. Utterly unconditional love, purer love than almost anything we've seen in the show, and they died together for it. Dying in the arms of the woman he loved was one subverted expectation that I'm not angry about. And to be honest, their death while embracing each other made me cry more than anything else in this season. I agree with those who say that we didn't need to see a gruesome death for Cersei. Sure, she deserved it, but she's always been a very human character at her core. That's what made her different from all the other villains in this show. So I think it was a great decision to remind us of that in her last moments. I was surprised at how sorry I felt for her when she looked so scared. And to add to that, just the way that it was filmed, seeing death basically approaching them slowly, it built up so much tension and anxiety and sadness in me. It might be controversial to say, but to me, their death was excellently done. I just think that Jamie's character had a lot of that same internal struggle that is not so easy to convey without listening to his thoughts. It was mostly conveyed with facial expression, so I'm not surprised at how confusing it felt. In my mind though, same as with Danny, the execution didn't take away from the essence of his character arc. And by the way, if you would like to hear more about Jamie's arc along this same line of thinking, I would highly recommend Jessen's video. He explained it a lot better than me, so go pay him a visit once you're done here. I was also not bothered by the lack of a literal Valonqar kill. We've always known to take it with a grain of salt, because the Valonqar part of the prophecy was never mentioned in the show. You could say it happened metaphorically, but that's a deeper discussion for another time. So I liked Cersei's death, but that's not to say that I liked her storyline this season. I just wish she had done more. Her actions were very underwhelming, especially in this episode. I feel like episode 4 really hurt episode 5 here. Killing Rhaegal and Missandei would have probably made more sense to do in the middle of the battle, rather than while Dany was traveling south. It felt contrived how she was able to cause so much damage by attacking two dragons and an entire fleet during their travels, to then not being able to cause any damage at all when the city was being attacked. Something that she was a lot better prepared for, with ton more scorpions, a ginormous sellsword army, and she was going against only one dragon. You could say that Dany's anger made her more dangerous, but that wasn't enough of an explanation. It's also hard to believe that Cersei did not have any backup plans. She's delusional, but not that delusional. I fully expected her to have a hidden scorpion somewhere that would hit Drogon while he was perched on that tower. Maybe this could have been a more believable trigger for Dany's anger, using Drogon to burn as much of the city as possible as he bled out. I don't know, again, it could have been done in many different ways that didn't feel so contrived. Maybe you're okay with it, maybe what Cersei did was exactly what you expected her to do, but it really fell flat for me. Varys was another character who suffered greatly from the writing. Even the actor, Conleth Hill, has spoken out about how it affected him. But at the same time, I can't bring myself to blame the writers for this one. Same as with Littlefinger. Varys is one of the most complex characters in George R. R. Martin's world, and he must be so incredibly difficult to write for. I don't mind Varys dying for his betrayal, but it would have definitely benefited from a slower pace in the narrative, with more cunningly planned moves than just telling Jon straight to his face in the middle of an open area that he thought he should be the one to rule. I will say though that his goodbye with Tyrion was very impactful still. Remembering how close their friendship had become and how they were the only friend that they each had really got to me. The Tyrion and Jaime scene was great too. I was really digging that whole family theme and the loyalty that all of the Lannisters have for each other. It was really endearing to me, and honorable, in a way. I know it didn't make much sense for Jaime to say that he didn't care about the innocent, since he did save the innocent by killing the Mad King, but I can believe that he mainly killed the Mad King because he had asked Jaime to kill Tywin, and saving the innocent was just a side effect. We can't deny that the dialogue could have definitely been clearer, but I wasn't too bothered by that line specifically. And of course, I did tear up at the end. A really good performance by Peter Dinklage. But yeah, there was so much of that end of the road feeling in this episode. To think that all of these characters have come so far, so much has happened to them, and now they're finally here, at the end of everything. This is it. This is really the last time they're ever going to see each other. And that was intensely sad for me. Same with Arya and the Hound. Despite events feeling once again contrived, I'd really love to see her calling him Sandor before saying goodbye forever. It was really sweet. Now, Clegane Bowl I loved as well. You could say that it was a regression for Sandor, but I personally took it as him finally using that hate for something good. My character arc can definitely begin and end in the same place, as long as some major change has happened, and that definitely happened to Sandor. Arya calling him by that name was symbolic of it. So I would be willing to say that this was another subjective character arc and not so much bad writing. Being violent was always his nature. To stop his nature altogether would not feel very realistic. But learning to change the way that he directs that violence is still a good character arc, in my opinion. It would have just made more sense if he wasn't using his violence simply for personal revenge, but in order to save someone from the mountain instead. Like he did in season 1 when he was trying to save Loras. I did like that the Hound died with his brother, though. That's what I kept expecting. And I also expected the mountain to kill Qyburn, so I was satisfied with that as well. Now, there was a pretty clear setup at the end of the episode for what Arya will want to do next. She's definitely got a new silver-haired lady on her list. And yeah, she got on that white horse that everyone's saying it's supposed to represent death. To be honest, all I thought in that moment was that Arya was dead, and she was simply seeing some afterlife hallucinations or something. But anyway, even though I do get the symbolism, I still found that scene pretty corny. But this whole Arya wants to kill Dany now seems too obvious of a distraction, and a lot of us doubt that Arya will get to kill another major character. So it's easy to believe that someone else will do it. And who better than Jon, the one major character who has really had no special event in his plot this season. I have no idea how they're going to do it though, since Dany still has Drogon and an army that keeps spawning new soldiers somehow. Seriously, how is her army still so big? I thought David and Dan said that what we saw in episode 3 was the end of the Dothraki. Anyway, what are they going to do with the army and the dragon if they kill Daenerys? At this point, I would love to see the Starks ruling all of Westeros, but the writers can really make anything they want happen. The characters are not really moving the plot themselves anymore, it's more like the plot is moving the characters now. So I'll just patiently wait and see. Oh yeah, and Euron and Harry Strickland, completely useless characters. Nothing else to say there. Thank you so much for watching, leave a like if you liked it, subscribe for more, click on the bell to get notified about my new videos, and I will see you in the next one!